Hey, it's me, E. Let's upgrade our setup from 2 monitors to 1. Let's get it. So, as you may have seen on my setup videos right here or right here, I'm actually using 2 monitors or a dual monitor setup as most of my streamer friends would be doing. That is because you want to have one stream or one monitor dedicated for stream chats and alerts and the other one for your gameplay. However, as I've continued to stream, I felt that is very space consuming for my desk. And as you know, I always want to do some unboxing videos for you and me and this channel. That's why I wanted to make or free up some real estate on the table. Now you may say, oh E, yeah, I mean, you can just get a new table and that's where you want to do setup, but space is an issue wherever we are. That's why I was thinking maybe I could just downgrade or upgrade, however you want to see it, into a 1 monitor setup. Okay, I've scoured the internet on how to do it. I haven't seen any, so this is my attempt in doing so. But before that, I got an exciting news for you. I actually got 1 monitor right now that will replace both. This prism setup. What I decided to get is this Prism X340 or 340 Pro. It is a 34-inch monitor, 100Hz refresh rate, and apparently it has a 3440x1440 resolution. Now, to put things into perspective, the normal scale for OBS is about 1980x1080. So this means that the screen real estate for that monitor is bigger than actually the solution that I just mentioned a while ago. Nah. The reason why I wanted that is that I wanted to incorporate my stream chat there in this monitor and lay it out so that I won't need 2 monitors. Let's see if I can do it. But before that, we want to talk about price, right? This bad boy set me back about $548 or with the Arxtel Pro monitor arm, it set me back right about 700 SGD for the both of them. That would roughly be around 500 or 600 US something. So not that bad. For the price range, I say it's very competitive against its other monitor options out there. Shout out to those gangs, but this is locally made. From what I understand, this is done in Singapore, so I'm gonna unbox it. Ooh. Right. Hope I'm opening it the right side up. This is what you get on top. This is, I believe, the legs, which we won't be using, so I will not be touching it. Ooh. But for the sake of unboxing, maybe I'll remove it in a few. Power brick and studs. Right off the gate, you get this lovely 34-inch monitor, and it comes with these stands right here. So out of the box, you can actually opt to just get the actual monitor. It will come with this lovely stand. The stand is made out of steel, but it is set. It looks like it's actually preset to a specific height, so you can't really adjust it. And this is the stand. At least the the bracket holder for the monitor is steel, and this looks like also steel. Yeah, well made. Good job, Prism. So by the looks of it, it might take a 12-inch that way. So that if you're going with this look, you would need to have at least 12-inch of real estate. So since I'm using a 40cm or 60cm table from IKEA, 120x60, and I don't want to use this because it would take too much real estate and it will defeat the purpose of the entire exercise, okay? So that's why I'm going to set this aside. It comes with this neatly packaged holder, screw holder. I think these are for the VESA mount and other peripheralia that you need in order for you to operate the monitor. This is obviously the cord for the monitor. And this is the bracket for, well, the monitor again. You also get a free HDMI cable. Standard for monitors. And I think this is a mounting plate. So as you can see here, these are VESA points and the mounting plate. Instruction manual and a riser for the mounts. All right, cool. Now that's out of the way, and set aside, and open up our Prism. Boom, look at that. So sexy. Curved and heavy. This bad boy is heavy. Not so heavy, but you know what I mean. Ooh. It is definitely a hefty beast. So it's a curved monitor, so as specified in the sight, it should be able to cover your vision from left to right. You don't have to tilt your head back and forth. I will be doing a test. Well, I'll be using it, and then I'll be telling you or updating you on my Instagram. So if you haven't, follow your boy, Instagram right here. All right, so let's look at what's on the monitor. So from the looks of it, you don't have a switch or a button on top, but rather on the bottom. It's a circular button. Right there. You have the power on and actually I would assume these are power on and other options, but there's no label behind. On the bottom part, you don't need another power brick. It looks like the power brick is already inbuilt on the PC, on the monitor, which is actually good. I really like that design, because whenever you're trying to cable manage specific monitors, the thing that is really kind of tricky is managing the power brick on the bottom part. So kudos to that one. We do have three HDMI cables, but note that only one is HDMI 2. You have a display port, and I believe this is an audio jack out. So that's quite cool. There's an audio jack out here. This is the speaker configuration, and other than that, that's it. On the backhand side, there is a I think this is an inbuilt LED or like a LED light. So if you have known, I have switched away from strips because it makes my eyes a bit dirty. Plus, I think it's played out, so that's what it is. Now I need to show you what we have on the mount. The monitor comes with these Arc Stealth Pro monitor arm. Nothing special. This is just basically a monitor arm. If you have already a monitor arm that can support a 34-inch load, then by all means, you don't have to get this. But I think it depends on the weight of the monitor. Check the description of the product or the description of your arm as well, just to be on the safe side. Let's just open this bad boy. For both the packaging, it kind of resonates with, to me, is a Samsung feel right now. It's not more of a Apple feel because I've felt that the white covering is just coating on top of the cardboard. Yes, cardboard is the word that I'm looking for. All right, cool. What you get is an instruction manual, standard. You have your arm to hold the monitor, and this is a clamp. This looks like a hefty clamp. Very huge compared to other monitor arm that I have previously. As you know, I did the dual monitor. This is even thicker than that dual monitor clamp. So looks like it's meant to hold a lot of weight. Screws that are pre-named MA, MB, MC, MD. This is always helpful. MA, MB, MC, MD. This is always helpful when you're trying to assemble. For the novice ones, you don't have to figure out which one is A, B, C, or D. This is already pre-labeled for you. That's cool. All right. I also, I'm appreciative of the guys that includes the tools thereof. So I think this is usually the norm now. You have your wrench right here. I think it's a wrench, right? Two different sizes. But that's also okay. I thought about it. And I think it's one of the components, if I'm not mistaken. This could be an angle for an expansion for the monitor. Maybe. The VESA mount plate. But to be honest, Your prism already got comes with a Vesa mount plate, so you may not need this. You have the monitor arm right here. I think this is for an expansion. I'm getting a lot of things here. I think this is could be for the wires, which we won't have too much. And finally, we have the pillar. Okay, so only one thing left to do now. Try to get this out of the way, and that is to assemble the beast. Right, let's assemble them together. That was a handful. Now, these are my opinions about the Prism 340 Plus from the eyes of a novice consumer. I am neither a monitor expert, therefore I don't really consider the refresh rates. Those numbers really means nothing to me unless I Google them and they say they are actually really good. What sRGB means and what's the gradient meaning and how much color the monitor has. For me, this review or this observation on my end is coming in from a consumer that wants to get in the widescreen monitor experience that knows nothing about it. Let's look at the pros. The pros for this product are it is definitely cheaper than most of the known monitor brands out there. Barring any other sale out there, it is definitely more bang for your buck. However, it comes with some concessions. Number one, the make and feel of the monitor itself definitely is not premium. However, it is satisfactory enough. The make of the monitor itself outside is it feels like it's hardened plastic. However, the aesthetics wise, it doesn't take away from the huge monitor experience and the curvature itself and the panel and the colors thereof. Admittedly, you won't be touching your monitor anytime soon or always anyway. So the question becomes, is it going to be distracting enough for you to consider not buying? For me, it's not. It is. It has a matte finish onto it, and therefore it's not that much issue. Plus, the side bezels here are slim enough so that you don't really consider it as a deal breaker. Which brings me to the monitor buttons. It is still on plastic make. It is not premium feel, however, it has enough resistance that would suggest that it could last a long period of time. That being said though, this buttons doesn't have any labels or markers into them. Therefore, you would either need to look at the manual that the TV comes along with or try a trial and error method that I did. So it's a bit intuitive. I would say the farthest right corner of the button would turn it on and off. The next one would go to a mode sequence. The next one would be the down. I would say it's a down function, meaning that if it's an option, it's a down function. The other one is the up function. And the last one, I believe, is the option to go to the settings. And then if you click it, it will click into a nested scene of that settings and so on and so forth. Now, it may take time for you to explore each and every category of the settings. However, I don't think there are any options in the setting that would definitely skew the function of the monitor. So I would say it is childproof-ish in terms of the design. Also, there is no power brick in the monitor. Cable management wise, if you're really up into that specific spectrum of like design and aesthetics, it's really good that it doesn't have an external power brick. However, it has a concession with monitor weight because the power brick is built into your monitor. Therefore, your monitor would be a bit heavier on that side. Speaking of the monitor, the backhand side offered a blue LED function. However, in terms of the glow or the brightness of that LCD, the blue LCD behind the monitor, it doesn't really give enough oomph, if you know what I mean. If you're going for that LCD pimped out look behind your monitor, that LED functionality would not be dependable. From my perspective, it's even better for you to put in your own LED strip so that you get that LED finish and not rely on the built-in LED. A side note to the design factor as well, it might have not been wise to put that functionality given that it's not going to increase the likeliness of people utilizing that function to make them buy the product. Maybe consider putting in a brighter LED behind it or putting a bit more bigger LED real estate so that it has that better glow, or forego them altogether so that you have enough or it lessen out the space behind it, or consider the weight or the voltage that is required. Maybe consider. Since we talked about the weight of the monitor and the power brick is built into the monitor itself, I believe, I would say that the monitor itself is hefty. I would say it's around 10 to 20 kg if I'm not mistaken. I would need to read out the specs of the monitor, but it is definitely heavy. The Arc Stealth Pro that it came along with definitely was ample enough to carry it. However, if you're going to pair it with subpar desk like the IKEA Linman table, which is mostly sort of a not really a solid wood table, if you know what I mean, it would definitely yield some damages. Like for myself, I placed in initially the arm on the farthest corner of the table so that it has this long arm reach, and then my monitor should be here and my stand would be here so that I can achieve a clean look on the bottom of my monitor. But because of the monitor weight, my entire setup or the entire arm was leaning to the right hand side in favor of the monitor weight, thus incurring a little bit of table damage on my end. So what I end up doing is I adjusted the monitor arm and the placement of the base so that it's closer to the epicenter of the weight. And now it's holding up fine. So to be clear, the monitor arm that it comes along with can hold the weight. The question is it consistently holding it when it's hyperextended? I would say it is hard pressed to do so. There are times wherein the arm would just go towards the back end side because that's where the heavy parts are, and you have to angle it and then tighten it really, really, really well so that it doesn't do that specific item. But if you're going to hard lock your monitor arm, it kind of defeats the purpose of having a monitor arm, because you want that you can actually angle or twist and turn your monitor as you choose. That's just coming in from me. To remedy that, I just needed to move the base of the monitor arm closer to the epicenter, as I said before, and then it's now functioning as it should. Something to consider. Now that we have done with the aesthetics, let's go towards the function of the monitor. I would like to correct myself. A while ago, I did mention that it comes with an HDMI cable as standard with all other monitors. I was used to having a 1080p monitor that was the standard for those monitors. This actually came in with a DisplayPort ADP for this specific monitor, not an HDMI. So just a note, if you are upgrading from an HDMI 1080p like myself, just consider this specific use case. So for myself, I did use my old HDMI to plug in the HDMI 2.0 in this monitor, and sadly, it did not pick up the G-Sync functionality from the monitor to my PC. What does that mean? That means that the PC or my computer still thinks that my monitor is 1080p. Therefore, it doesn't go by on the 3440 by 1440, which is the widescreen orientation or resolution itself. It did not detect that one. I even tried going into specific forums, which suggests that I can overwrite my resolution on my GPU. By the way, I'm using a Super 1660 GPU on my end. So you can actually have a customized function there to go and force the resolution to go 3440 by 1440. However, the result is quite unsatisfactory. There is going to be a little bit of like smudging on the color because it's not native to the settings from my understanding. I tried using my DisplayPort to HDMI as well, which yielded no positive results. What corrected this value is that when I used my DisplayPort connected to the DisplayPort of this monitor using their free cable that comes along with it. With that, the sync turned on and it actually recognizes the monitor as a widescreen monitor. So if it was on the manual itself, I couldn't find it. Might be something that I would need to dive into. I tried to find it in the forums or like the help page itself. I haven't seen it. I might be mistaken. If I am, please comment the link in the description down below to help further Prism enthusiasts or further monitor consumers to the widescreen meta and help them with their journey. The last thing that I want to talk about is the color aspect ratio and the color experience that I have. So this monitor comes in with three settings: the warm, the cool, and the user. So the warm is geared towards red, the red spectrum. That means that the color is a bit more reddish. The other one, which is cool, is geared towards blue. And the user, I think, is somewhere in between or yellowish, if I'm not mistaken. So what I did for myself is that since I'm doing some video edits like this, I actually did a color edit via Spider. And I know you would say, oh, that's a bit pricey. There are other options. Yes, there are other options. I was told that there were other options which are pricing from $100 itself. Spider right now is around $300 to $330 Sing dollars. So that would add into your cost of buying this monitor. However, fret not though. There are options out there. If you go to Carousel, you would see people actually renting out the service for only $10. So that's a different option that I took personally myself. The dude came into the house and actually fixed it for me, which is very good because he is more knowledgeable in calibrating the monitor, described to me or patiently went over what each specific item means and what the calibrator is doing and how to set up the calibration going forward. So if you're into photos and a photo enthusiast or beginner to medium editor or for YouTube content such as this that you try to edit your videos as yourself, this would be a viable option. So overall, what is my experience with the product? Definitely, because I am new to the widescreen monitor meta, there were a couple of learning experience from my end. But because of the price point of the monitor, you are encouraged to explore what the monitor can do without being afraid of the damage repercussions. The other thing is that, as I said, the options here are sort of childproof, so you can't really go wrong. The worst thing you can do is like oversaturate or overbright your monitor, and you can actually just go to the settings and go to the reset function, which is super nice. The other thing that I wanted to talk about is that I've seen a lot of YouTube clips saying that it might be hard pressed for you to look at spreadsheets, Excel spreadsheets and whatnot because of like the run-ons, I think, ? From my experience after the calibration, I did not have that issue on my end. I really like the functionality of this monitor that I can see the entire spreadsheet. If you're working on Alteryx and any of those macros, you can see the entire workflow from left to right, which is super nice. And if you're also doing Outlooks and emails, it's also very helpful. Now finally to my point why I bought this monitor because of my of streaming. What is my experience with the streaming? There is definitely a learning curve on how to utilize this monitor for your streaming experience. How I do it is that I set a specific frame for the 1080p and for the rest of position, my OBS, my chats, and everything that I needed to see in one go. But after you have set that one up and be assimilated to it, I feel that my workflow is better than what it was before. There's just one screen. You know where to look in specific fashion. You don't have to do this one because you have multi-screens like this. It is definitely at eye level. Everything is at eye level. And if you have positioned your camera well, the audience would not really think that you're reading chats. It would just seem that you're actually just looking at the game itself. However, just a disclaimer, I'm not playing any FPS games on my end. As you know, this is MTG, Magic the Gathering, and the most I could do is MTGA, which is a Magic the Gathering Arena. It is not refresh rate or FPS first-person shooter intensive games. Therefore, if you're asking me about the refresh rates, I can't tell you much about it. The most thing I can do is actually just Dota. So for me, it's very adequate in streaming, and it captures what my initial thought of having this monitor and applying it to my streaming can do for my workflow. Last but not least is the video editing that I mentioned a while ago. Well, we're color grading now. It also works with video editing, so you can see your timeline from left to right. Because you have enough resolution, the real estate from top to bottom is also superb. I'm using DaVinci Resolve to edit some of my videos as well, so I really like that functionality that I can see it at one go. Just a side note, I will not be covering in this video how I use a widescreen monitor and how I laid out my entire workflow or stream workflow so that it functions really, really well. I'll be creating that portion in a different video. So, overall, will I recommend Prism X340 Plus to you? If you're a beginner in this widescreen meta and you're in a budget, definitely this is a no-brainer. Get the monitor itself, have a feel on what it can do for your workflow, and if you're not too picky with the color correction, you can even opt to not calibrate it. The color without being calibrated is good enough. I just want it for myself to make sure that my color when I'm editing is what you also see there on your end. However, if you're even more advanced, I'm on the fence on this one. Maybe consider a different Prism line. I might be mistaken though, you know, let me know in the comment section down below. So, if you enjoyed this review and slight upgrade on my setup, please give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing. If you have any questions that you want me to answer personally, catch me on stream. Here are my stream time. And I think that's it. As always, stay safe, y'all.